Ona Munson. Miss Munson, please. Paging Miss Ona Munson.
Oh, hello there.
Oh, good evening, Miss Munson. I've been looking for you. Your guests are already at your table in the celebrity room.
Did you say guests? You mean more than one? Well, I was just expecting Miss Lee Miller, war correspondent and photographer for Vogue magazine. Is there someone else?
Oh, yes, a gentleman. And when he asked for you, he sounded like an Englishman.
Well, we are in luck. Two guests tonight instead of one, and a Britisher at that.
Gee, Miss Munson, is the woman with him a real live lady war correspondent?
Yes, a real live one, Jimmy. So maybe you'd better leave word at the desk that Miss Lee Miller and, well, say a mysterious Englishman will be in the celebrity room.
Yes, ma'am. And thank you, Miss Munson.
And as your hostess, Ona Munson, makes her way to that special mic-side table in the celebrity room, it's time to remind you that it's the get-together hour in radio's smart rendezvous of famous people from all over the world. It's time for In Town Tonight. You'll always meet headline personalities when you drop into the celebrity room with Ona Munson. So let's do a little eavesdropping as she chats with this evening's special guests.
You know, Lee, I'm afraid the bellhop didn't believe me when I said you were a real, live lady war correspondent.
That isn't the first time I run into skepticism, Ona. But I think what really threw him was when he found out that you had two guests instead of one.
Yes.
I'd like you to meet my good friend, Roland Penrose.
Oh, how do you do, Mr. Penrose?
I hope you don't mind my coming along to watch, Miss Munson.
Oh, I know. On the contrary, I'm delighted, Mr. Penrose. You know, usually two women need a man to balance the conversation. And besides, your name's so familiar. Aren't you the Roland Penrose who introduced surrealism to England?
She's got you there.
Maybe I was partly responsible, Miss Munson.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. Well, I'm afraid you will never get away without taking your turn at the microphone, then.
Well, really, I hadn't thought I was
Oh, well, now, we'll get around to you later, Mr. Penrose. But first, I'm going to concentrate on Lee Miller. I know that anyone who has ever seen a Lee Miller picture or article in Vogue magazine must want to know a lot about you, Lee.
Well, fire away, Ona. I'll try real hard to sound like a fabulous character.
Well, that would just be typecasting. First, I think we'd better clear up just how you happened to be a photographer in the first place.
That's an easy one, Ona. You see, I wanted to be an artist, a painter, that is, and I went to Italy one summer to study. I saw every ruin and picture in the country.
And it inspired you to want to paint masterpieces like that,
It inspired me to give the whole thing up.
Oh!
It just seemed to me that every picture had been painted in every possible way.
And so you said, I'll be a photographer instead.
As a matter of fact, I think those were my very words.
Well, how do you go about becoming a photographer? It can't be so simple.
I don't know how other photographers go about it, but I thought the best way was to start out studying with one of the great masters in the field, Man Ray.
Well, that was a good choice, all right. But I thought Man Ray didn't take students.
He doesn't, as a rule. He was in Paris at that time, so I went to him and said, hello, I'm your new student and apprentice.
And what did he say?
Just what you might expect. He said, oh, no, you're not. I don't have students or apprentices.
And then you said?
I said, you do now. And I worked with him for 4 years.
Well, I'm sure that studying with a great photographer like Man Ray was invaluable training.
It was, Ona. And when I began actually working on my own and on Vogue magazine, I realized how invaluable it was.
That was on the Paris staff of Vogue, wasn't it?
Yes. My pictures and articles appeared in American Vogue, but I've always worked over there.
Well, how did it happen that you didn't come home when war broke out?
Well, I had planned to come back to the States, but when the war started, I thought that since I'd had my fun over there, I'd better stick around and work, too.
So you became Vogue's war correspondent?
Well, no. I became Vogue's war photographer. You see, I only started writing by accident.
That sounds intriguing. Well, how did it happen?
Well, the girl who was supposed to write the articles that I took pictures for called one day and said, we're going to interview Ed Murrow.
You mean the CBS director of the Overseas News Bureau?
Yes, the same. She went on to say that she didn't know Mr. Murrow. She was sick with a cold, and anyway, she hated radio. Would I do the interviewing?
Well, of course, you said you would.
Well, I said yes, sort of absent-mindedly, but I don't think I said of course. And then I was terrified. I didn't have any idea how to go about interviewing anyone.
Or was it really such a horrible ordeal?
No, it was fun. Mr. Murrow was such a wonderful person. He must have realized right away that I didn't know anything about interviewing or writing either. And he helped me out so that I got together quite a decent article.
And did the Vogue editors approve?
Yes, they approved and asked for more.
Good.
So you see how easy it is to be a writer.
Well, maybe. Well, anyway, from then on you started to write articles to go along with your pictures.
Yes, that's right. I often did an article on a country, Romania, Hungary, Denmark, for instance, with a series of pictures to go along with them.
Oh, yes. I remember some of those articles, and very fine they were, too. Also, I seem to remember some excellent pictures taken by one Lee Miller of Dachau and Buchenwald prisons, and a couple of shots of that same Lee Miller taking a bath in Hitler's bathtub and sleeping on Hitler's bed after the fall of Munich.
Oh, no, that's not fair. You've been looking at Vogue again.
Well, fair or not, we want to hear about it. But I will give you a breather, Lee, while you gather together those notes on your war experiences. We'll turn the spotlight on Edie Griffith and Rack Godwin, our piano team, while they give us a 20-finger version of Serenade to a Wealthy Widow. And now back to Lee Miller. How about it, Lee? Are you ready to tell us some more of those war experiences of yours?
Well, if I do, Eleanor, I'll have to preface all of it by saying I was very lucky.
Well, how do you mean?
Well, most correspondents were assigned to cover one army, and they moved as that army moved and reported those maneuvers. But since Vogue only had one war correspondent, Lee Miller, I got to rattle around all over the place.
Well, Lee, wasn't there some ruling about women not being allowed where there was fighting?
Sure there was. And for a while, it looked like I was going to be court-martialed for being where I wasn't supposed to be. But honestly, only it wasn't my fault.
I see. You just looked up, and there was a battle.
Well, practically. I had my orders to cross the channel. It was shortly after D-Day. I got on an LST. Halfway across, the LST had his orders changed.
And where did it land?
On another beach. I was right in the middle of a siege.
And as long as you were there and just happened to have your camera...
Naturally, I took pictures. You can't blame a girl for that when she has a battle right in her lap.
I should say not. But what about that picture of Berchtesgaden burning? How did you happen to be right up there at Hitler's hideaway at the right moment?
Well, let's see. I'd have to go back a bit for that. You see, I went in the day they took Munich. I've been carrying Hitler's Munich address around in my pocket for years, and finally I had a chance to use it.
So you went calling?
Yes, but mine host wasn't home. However, he had so recently been there that his private telephone wires were still operating, and one of the soldiers picked up the phone. I took some pictures of the place, and I also got a good night's sleep in Hitler's bed. And I even washed the dirt of Dachau off in his own tub.
But Berchtesgaden, what about that?
Well, I was barreling along the road in my own car, just as innocently as anything, and some 3rd Division boys I'd known in Alsace went by. They hollered that they were going to Berchtesgaden. Why didn't I come along?
So there you were, trapped again.
Certainly. A girl can't refuse an invitation from a member of our armed forces.
Certainly not.
I went, and only you'll have to admit, that shot of Berchtesgaden on fire after it was blown up was really well lovely, wasn't it?
Oh, it was an excellent picture, Lee, as those over your name usually are. I remember particularly the ones taken at Dachau and Buchenwald prisons.
I hope no one will ever forget the subject matter for those pictures. I won't. I was very proud of my magazine for printing those. Vogue doesn't go in much for printing horror stories, and that's just what those were.
Well, perhaps it's good that the war photographers did put those things down on film, Lee, because otherwise I'm sure most of us would think it had all been a hideous nightmare.
Yes. Here in America, it does seem like that.
Well, it's hard for all of us over here to comprehend what the people in Europe have been through. Now, even though we've only skimmed the surface of your experiences, Lee, I'm going to turn over the microphone to Roland Penrose. Oh, you look startled, Mr. Penrose. Did you think we were going to forget you?
As a matter of fact, I was hoping that perhaps you'd forgotten that earlier threat.
Oh, not a chance. And anyway, it's not a very far step from photographs to painting. Tell me about the showing of the surrealist painters in England that we spoke about earlier.
It was back in 1936. You see, I'm a painter myself.
Mm-hmm.
I had come over from Paris and was anxious to bring with me the work of some of my surrealist friends, which at that time was very little known in England.
Well, you're speaking of surrealists from all the European countries, aren't you?
Oh, yes. There were Danish, Swedish, Belgian, Swiss, Italian, Romanians, as well as French and American. Also, there were many English poets and painters associated with the exhibition, including the sculptor Henry Moore, who is to have an important exhibition out here this winter.
Mm-hmm. Well, how was the exhibition received?
Oh, it was a roaring success. It has become a milestone in the understanding of modern painting in England.
Well, you know, we could get into a whole discussion of modern artists, and we'd also be here for hours. But tell me, Mr. Penrose, what about your experiences in the war? Did you go barreling around Europe like our real live lady war correspondent we have with us here?
No, I'm afraid my war experiences were dull in comparison to hers. I was in the army, in the camouflage department.
Oh, once again, art rears its head.
Well, yes, camouflage is certainly an art, and not altogether unlike surrealism. They kept us very busy during the war.
Not too busy for that off-the-record trip to Paris, I noticed.
Well, this sounds interesting, Mr. Penrose.
Well, yes, it was. The trip he's referring to became a book.
Oh.
You see, I came back with some information about the intellectuals of Paris. That is, the artists, writers, poets, scientists, and so on. And the way in which they'd been working in the Paris underground. I was surprised to find how very important their role had been.
And did you publish your findings?
Yes, I put them into a small book. And the Ministry of Information sponsored its publication.
And what did you give your book for a title?
I called it In the Service of the People. The slogan used by the resistance editors.
Well, tell me, is your visit here in America an off-the-record trip?
Well, it's certainly unofficial. Just a visit. But I am gathering information about the museums in this country, particularly those that are unofficial, such as the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And when I get back, I want to see what can be done in England along similar lines.
Well, for an unofficial visit, that sounds very busy to me.
Also, I've seen some most remarkable collections of modern painting here in California, and had the pleasure of finding some of my old friends, Max Ernst, Man Ray, Tongi, Berman.
Well, now comes the question to end all questions, Mr. Penrose. Since you've never been in America before, what's your impression of our country? How do you like the United States and California?
Now, that's a question I've been hoping to avoid. It really isn't fair, you know. I haven't been here long enough.
Now, I think you're evading the issue. Are you trying to keep Anglo-American relations on solid footing?
Perhaps, but I'll say this. There's a wonderful feeling of luxury here and a wonderful lack of restrictions.
And I'd like to say that it's been wonderful to have had the opportunity to talk to you and Lee Miller here in our celebrity room. I hope you'll both drop around to see us if you should ever be in this neighborhood again. Thanks for coming, and best wishes to both of you.